Namuku yaku yendaririra
yendaririra
namukuriya yendaririra
yendaririra.
Once upon a time, almost every civilization on the face of the earth understood masks and used masks in some part of their life as a tribe or as a group. They understood that there was some enlivening force behind us that was really who we were, and that our skin, our face, our identity was really a mask, and that all things in creation, trees, mountains, were really the plastic manifestations of who the spirit really is. It is only recently that we decided that masks were too frightening, were too close to the truth. We've made them a huge taboo in our culture. So I find that today we still are searching for who we truly are, to understand how are we part of the Creator. Art and masks seem to go together to me. They're part of that creative force that allows us to see more about who we are. And I am learning a lot about who I am through this work. All my life, I've loved to be outside and with nature. I love to feel the wind in my hair. I love the feeling of the earth. Working with fiber has been one way for me to stay in that place, or to go to that place, actually, when I need comfort and to be with something that's very natural. For me, the mask making has been an astonishing way to see myself. My sister gave me this loom 30 years ago, and ever since, I have been weaving on it, hopefully with a wood fire at my back and the October sun slanting in on the loom. And I'm always happy when I'm weaving. One of the oldest ways of spinning is to spin on a rock. And sometimes I come down to the beach and just begin wrapping a rock that I find with yarn. I feel like we're all spinning on a rock as we sit here on the earth. We are a rock spinning in space. And it reminds me of that. And I like putting wool into the masks, and especially the hand spun yarn that's been spun on the rock. Where my fingers are touching, right here, is the point that I have to be present. Because where it's already spun all the way up here is the past. And where my fingers are pinching, that's the present. And in this big fluff on my shoulder, that's the future, it's unformed. So there's only one point that I can ever do anything on this yarn, and that's the very point where I'm pinching, where my fingers are. That's where I have to pay attention. So I think of that while I spin. I have to pay attention to the present moment. I use an old trunk lid for a loom. This was in my room as a child, and this is what I weave on. We used to keep our treasures in this, my sister and I, and I think I was sitting on this trunk when I learned how to tie my shoelaces. And finally the hinges broke, and so when I needed a loom, here it was. So I'm using a linen thread that I just wrap around. One of the reasons I love using this little portable loom is that I can begin my mask or work on my mask wherever I am. And sometimes I start out by the beach and then I take it into my studio and work on it, or can be wherever I'd like to be. I like the idea that the treasures I make now are made on the trunk instead of being in it. I make masks because I had a vision of how to make them. And ever since I began experimenting, I have discovered that masks really represent reality in a way that I had never known before. It's like making up a story somehow. You know, I just start at the very beginning. And as I go along, the story begins to unfold. Oh yes, I know now what to do next.
I notice that your love is a miracle. How deeply you're connected to my soul.
I use this work of mask making as an excuse to go inside myself. I like having a loom that has no heddles, no reed. It means that I can look at the warp and decide when it's wide enough for me, or if I want the threads closer together, it means that I can let some of the parts of it actually just close in, like this part over here at the right where the chin was. So that's it for this mask. And this is what the mask looks like on the loom before I cut it off. So after I finish weaving the mask, I usually turn the board over and then just cut the threads. Sometimes making these masks is like my life. They go from being woven flat to suddenly taking shape. When you take them off the loom and pull the threads together, then you can see what kind of shape it has. I love not knowing exactly who this is going to be, so it's not pre-planned. I just use my intuition. I try to really follow what's already inside. And here are the nostrils as they start to come up, and you can see the face just basically begin to form. These seem like mythical characters to me. And so usually stories come as I'm working. As I think about them, the whole story of who this person could be or what they might stand for arrives. You can see how their cheeks begin to sort of puff out. I love the evolution of learning more about the shape of the face and how you need to weave the faces. Every single mask is born. After they're woven, I put them onto a raw wool that then goes into the water, actually on a ball. I use a great big ball and I squish it in the water with the wool and soap, and I give it a bath. I just kind of warm, soapy bath. Then it emerges, and I push it off this ball as though it's being in labor, pushed out into the world. And there's this squishy, wet face. And then I have a chance to put it on my knee and take a look at who's arrived. Welcome. Yeah. Wow, you could probably have a big voice. I think my job in this world is to find out that the whole is inside me. That's the work I'm really doing, is to go inside myself a lot of the day so that I begin to really concentrate going behind the veil, going inside. Mostly when we close our eyes, it's just darkness. But I've discovered that there's more than darkness in there, and it's a wonderful place to be. And I think it's something that each of us has to do by ourselves. And because of that, I use this work of mask making as an excuse to go inside myself.
The hand-woven mask was given to me as a gift in a dream. I wrote the dream down and later wove the first mask on a 45-inch Leclerc four-harness loom in a bound weave pattern at the end of a rug warp. Since then, I have discovered that most ancient cultures have created masks to explore the nature of being human and divine. In world mask culture, I have not yet found an origin for flat woven wool masks shaped with warp pulling. But the promising dream of sharing them and the instructions on how to make them were very clear. I began to call them Zati masks because Zati is a word from the Urdu language, meaning from the spirit inside or from the inside out. The Zati mask begins with a flock of sheep who live on an island in the Atlantic Ocean off the coast of Maine. In June, for many years, I have helped at shearing time with the roundup of the flock and the rolling and grading of fleece. The sheep are hardy, and the wool is clean and lustrous. Long locks of the Lincoln Romney cross make up the fibers that I spin into yarn for the masks. Every Wednesday of the cold Maine winters is warmed for me by a group of women who have called themselves the Wednesday Spinners. We meet at each other's homes, the hostess making soup and coffee, and each spinner bringing something homemade and delicious, and we sit in a circle and talk about the meaning of our lives. All the yarn for the masks is spun in this way on a Wednesday. Some of us grow plants for dyeing our yarn in the summer. This is Suzanne Grosjean's harvest of madder roots, which create a beautiful red in the wool. And Japanese indigo, an annual yielding a true blue in a northern climate. With these materials, I head out into the woods to weave with my portable 7-stick journey loom. This has become more portable than my original trunk lid. I open it up, put it together, and can weave my mask in a beautiful place. Deep joy comes to me in the process of weaving. Each mask seems to design itself, and I love working with the natural dyes and island wool. Just as the yarns integrate with each other, I feel more unified and inspired as I weave. Here is a gallery of the Zati masks in the sequence in which they were woven.